Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua-Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Lord, we thank you for this beautiful morning, and we thank you that you are amongst your people, and we just pray now for that you would send your Holy Spirit. Lord, give us eyes to see, ears to hear, and a heart to receive what you have for us this morning. We pray that you use Pastor Izzy this morning to teach us and to encourage us for this coming week. We ask that now in Jesus' name, and all God's people said, amen.
Amen. Well, guys, if you turn in your Bibles to Romans chapter 3, we got through the passage of Scripture, the paragraph actually that has a key verse that we're going to continue building upon this morning. It's verse 23 of Romans 3. So Romans 3:23, and a lot of you already know this one because it's one of the most quoted verses out of the book of Romans. And I learned it in this thing called the road through Romans. It was a simple presentation of the gospel that said we all have sinned and fall what? Short. We all fall short of the glory of God. We're not one of us perfect. And the next verse says that we were justified as a gift by his grace through the redemption, it says, which is in Christ Jesus. Now, we broke this down last week, but for those of you that don't know these words, it's a Christian lingo. It's not what we usually speak in. I don't know if any of you used the word justified this week or redemption. It's just part of the next verse uses the word propitiation. I've used that in sentences a lot. Yeah, not. But we went over how Christ has made us justified. Now, justified, for easy remembrance for me, is just as if I never what? Sinned. Just as if I'd never sinned. He washes away my sin so completely that it looks like I've never sinned. It's just it's a spiritual cleansing of my shortcomings. And this is a really important key to what Paul is going to build on. First of all, we all are considered sinners. So we need someone to deal with that sin. And Paul says it was Christ who paid for our sin. He was the propitiation, which means the spiritual payment for our sin. He paid with his blood. And I brought that little booklet of the S&H green stamps to show you, you know, how each little box had to be put a stamp in it so you could redeem the thing at the redemption center. Well, there's a booklet for each one of us. Has every sin what we've committed in it. You know what Jesus did? He came and stamped every box with his blood. He blotted out my sin so that when you open the book and say, what do we have against Izzy? There's nothing. Because Christ has paid for my sin. And he made me justified. Okay, in God's sight, I'm now just. Just means right. I'm in right standing with God, a spiritual right standing with him because of what Christ did. It's an awesome thing. I can't boast like I'm so great. I did it. Who did the work? Jesus. And this is what Paul is going to lead into. This idea is what he's leading into this morning, what we're going to pick up with in Romans chapter 3, that it says then in verse 27, where then is boasting? You know, do I get to brag I'm so good? You know, Christ died for me, man. I'm so good. It's a good thing he has me on his team, you know, because he needed a winner, right? No. It's a good thing he's so good, and I'm really grateful that I get to be on his team. And I'm grateful that he was willing to pay for me. And for each of us, I mean, I don't know about you, but it makes me really appreciative of what Christ did when I learned that he would die in my behalf. He would shed his blood. He would pay with his blood to blot out my sin. I go, oh, the Bible says for a righteous man, one would hardly die. I mean, maybe. For a sinner, forget it. You know, like if they're just blown it, like I ain't dying for that. But if it's, you know, how some of those fellows that guard the president, the Secret Service guys, they'll lay down their life to protect the president. That's their job. It says for a righteous man, we would scarcely, but we would possibly die. But how about for the guy that's the murderer on death row? We'd be like, I'll take his place. No, we'd be like, let him go. I don't know. That is my Sicilian upbringing. We would just say, adios, you know, and bye-bye. You know, you did bad, you deserve to get punished. And that's the way I was brought up. But see, Christ comes and says, you did bad, but I'm going to pay for what you did wrong. I'm going to be the payment for that. Now, Paul says, well, then where then is boasting? Do we get to brag how great we are? We belong to Christ. We're in the club, man. We're the, you know, I listen to some Christians and you think they are the end-all, be-all of everything. They're like the best thing, you know, they're the best thing since what? Sliced bread has arrived on the planet? It's just, you're like, what? He says, listen, what? How do we boast? By what kind of law can we boast? By what of works can we boast? He says, no, not by the law. He says, but only by the law of faith. There is a principle of faith. He calls it a law of faith. That is the only reason we can boast is that God let us come to faith in what his son did. And if we're going to brag about anything, we get to brag about that faith that he gave. And faith, by the way, faith is an intangible. It's not something you get to physically see. But is it something real? I mean, how much does faith impact our course of life? You know, how we behave and how we treat others. You know, for people that grow up I notice people that grow up learning about God from an early age, they have a difference in how that their moral conduct, you know, how just morally, how they act towards others. They something has already been imprinted on them that there is a living God, and someday they'll be with him, and someday they, you know, every deed what we do, whether good or evil, we have to stand before God and give an account. That, by the way, that's believers. I know believers squirm when I tell them this, but I didn't make up the verses in Corinthians. When Paul was writing to the church at Corinth, he said, every deed we do, good or evil, we have to give an answer for. Now, I hope your answer is, the bad stuff I did, I did what it said in 1 John. I confessed that that was sin, and I let Christ forgive me my sin. And what does he do? Cleanse us of how much? All unrighteousness. So on the bad stuff, I hope that you have learned the good news that Christ is truly that spiritual cleaner of our soul. And that you can, you know, that's something that you can brag about. You know, really, you can brag about, man, it feels really good to have a Savior who washes my soul clean. Because I've done bad. I don't know about you, but I know I did a few things wrong. And it's so nice to have a God who says, yeah, I know you did some wrong stuff too. But I don't want it to separate you from me. So I'm going to pay the penalty of that sin so we can be together. Because, you know, the sin, it's a breach. It causes me to feel far from God. You know, sometimes people say to me, well, if God is real, how come I don't feel him? How come seems like he's not there? And I said, well, I don't know how to tell you this, but that's the same thing David described when he sinned with Bathsheba and killed her husband Uriah. He started feeling like God was gone. You know, Lord, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. And he's crying out, you know, God, I'm in trouble down here. I feel like your presence is gone. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord. Take not your Holy Spirit. There's something, his sin made him feel separated from God. And some people tell me this. They're like, I don't think there's really a God out there. I say, well, you know, he's there. But there's an issue that makes you feel devoid of his presence. And that's our sin. So the good news is, how many of us have sinned? All. Welcome to the club. We all have sinned. It's what do you do about your sin? When you find out that you're a sinner, which that's pretty easy. I look around, I'm preaching to the choir. I know you all figured this part out. What do we do about it? We go to the Lord and we say, Lord, forgive us. When you ask God's forgiveness for your sin, what does he say? Let me think about it. I'm not sure. You got me on a bad day. I don't feel forgiving. Does he say stuff like that?
No.
I know that some people think that that's the way God is because maybe they had parents or they had people that they looked up to, and whenever they asked their forgiveness, they were always I got conditions, you know, I'll forgive you if, or when, or, you know, and because we learn a conditional kind of relationship that goes along with the forgiveness that we receive down here, it's hard for us to fathom that there's a God that loves us unconditionally. He doesn't say, I love you if you're perfect. I love you if you do everything right. I love you when you do exactly what I want, right? Is that when he loves us? Or does he just say, I love you, period? See, his love is unwavering. And this is something that, guys, by the way, we're commanded in the scripture. It's not very, you know, for the guys that are married, don't think you get to have an option on this. It says in the book of Ephesians, husbands in chapter 5, it says, you are commanded to love your wife like what? Like Christ loved the church. And we don't get a, no wiggle room. It says Christ laid down his life for the church. He presented the church without any spot or wrinkle or any such thing. When he presents his bride, he goes, look at my bride. She's perfect. Now, I shared this at a wedding I was doing. I said to the guy I was getting ready to marry, this couple, Steve and Sharon Mitchell, I said, Steve, you have to love her the way Christ loved the church. And you have to, we've gone over these verses, but in front of all these people that are here, I'm going to tell you, they're my witnesses, that I am reminding you. You have to present her without any spot or wrinkle or any such. You can't say, look at her flaws, everybody. This is my wife. You have to say, look at my perfect wife. Isn't she wonderful? By the way, gals, does that feel good when you have a husband that presents you like that? You know, and that nourishes you and cherishes you and sanctifies. We went over that. He sets you apart above everyone else. You are on the top shelf in his heart. Now, when I asked at that wedding, it was back east, I said, you know, gals, how do you feel about this? If you could get a guy like this, this is how Steve, I'm telling him, he has to love her. And the back east girls jumped up and started saying, find me one. Just find me. And I was like doing a rhetorical question. I wasn't really expecting them to shout back, you know, but they're kind of brash back there. They're like, no, just, and they, funny. They were popping to their feet like popcorn, boom, 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 all over that thing going, find me one. Yeah, find me one. And I was like, and it was dim lighting out there. We were on a stage in this fancy hotel, and I was doing the wedding, and I'm looking out like, you know, and the lighting's low out there, and these girls look really, I mean, they dress up for weddings back there, okay? They look really hot. And I'm like, wow, what is wrong with you guys? I mean, all the girls that stood up, I could just see the young men just drooling, you know, like, whoa. And if they're saying that, it's telling me the guys are not doing what the Bible instructs. Because if we were, those gals' needs would be being met. Now, this is instruction from the Word of God of how we're to do what Christ did for us. And it's so important to understand. He presents you as his bride, as part of the bride of Christ, without any spot, without any wrinkle. No such thing as that. When he presents us, he's presenting us clean. Cleaned from those things. And how does it make you feel when you are presented like that? Look at this. This is my bride. She is this is my bride right here. Now, in my book, she's the perfect one, okay? Sorry to the rest of you guys. I got the perfect one. Well, perfect one for me. I learned to figure this out. There's one, God knows the right one for each one of us. And some of you, you're struggling because you're going, I don't know. So it's the guy's problem, really, because they're called our helpmate. And some guys don't like that word because, you know, by definition, helpmate, what it means, right? Helpmate means she's the one that helps who? Me. And what does that by definition imply? That I need? That I need help, right? See, this is the part the guys don't want me to teach. But any guy worth his salt will understand that this is a reality. From the beginning, when God made Adam and Eve, first he made Adam and he looked at him and he says, It's not good for man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him. And he made, God designed, now see, guys don't want me to teach this because from the beginning, God's design made us to need help. And it, you know what's interesting? It doesn't say she needs the help. It says we need the help. In fact, sometimes guys get in trouble when we try to help our wives because they're like, I didn't ask you to help. Well, you help me all the time. I thought I'd help you back. I got this. You know, I found that these women, they're wired to help us because we need help. Doesn't mean they're wired that they need our help sometimes. But do they need us to love them unconditionally? Do they need us to present them without spot or wrinkle or any such thing? Do they need us to nourish them and cherish them like Christ does the church? See, how does that make the gal feel when she's got a guy like that? See, God knew what he was doing when he laid out that wisdom in the scripture for us. But we like to ignore those things and pretend, I don't really need to do that. I'm just going to be abusive and a jerk and make her hang in there. That's dumb. You don't know what to do. Read Ephesians 5 or listen to one of the studies on Ephesians 5 of how we're supposed to love our wives. Now, Paul is the one who wrote those things to the church at Ephesus, and he's the same guy writing these words here in Romans. And remember, I told you, this book of Romans, Paul, this is the real in-depth version of building our faith. And in this version, he's going to go over one of the most important things about our faith that I'm going to have to give you a little background in the Old Testament about this guy Abraham today. Some of you will know the story already, but some of you will bring out a real cool understanding of what he's going to explain next. Because Paul goes on, he says, do we get to boast according to the law? That was, remember the Ten Commandments, what Moses gave, and then there in the book of Leviticus, they break that down into 613 Levitical statutes. Well, he says, do we get to boast because we know the rules? Because we follow the law? Paul says in verse 28, we maintain that a man is justified by faith apart from works of the law. Or is God only the God of the Jews? Is he not the God of the Gentiles also? Yes, Paul says, yes, he is indeed the God of the Gentiles. Since indeed God who will justify the circumcised by faith and the uncircumcised through faith, he is but one God. And do we then nullify the law through faith? Well, may it never be. On the contrary, we establish the law. And then, you know, this is to some Christians quagmire. They're like, well, how do we have to follow all those rules? And Jesus, when he was tested by that lawyer said, what's the greatest command in the law? You guys remember what the command was he told the fella? He says, well, how's it read to you? See, sometimes people ask me questions, they already know the answer. I learned this from Jesus. Just because they ask a question doesn't mean you have to answer it. Sometimes you can go, so what do you think? And he asked the attorney, so what do you think? And the guy says, well, I think you're supposed to love God with all your heart, your mind, your soul, your strength, you know. And love your neighbor. He says, well, good. Go do that and you'll live. The guy, he's like, well, then who's my neighbor? And that's when Jesus told the story about the Good Samaritan. The one who does good, who shows mercy to his neighbor. That's what it's about. It's Jesus said, I give you a new commandment. Remember in John chapter 13, verse 35, he says, a new commandment I give you, that ye what? Love one another. That's all there is to this. Love one another. Just love them. And if you don't know how to do it, it says love one another as you would have them what? Love you. That's a pretty easy definition because we already know what we want people to do for us. You'd be thinking, well, I wish someone would just rub my neck right here. It's really sore. When's the last time you went out and rubbed your spouse's sore neck? You know, they want others to do it to them. See, he gives the simplest instruction. Love one another as you would have them love you. This is love in action. This is doing it. So here, he says, the law is summed up with this one thing, to love. And in Matthew, Jesus, when he was speaking to the Pharisees, he said, listen, I did not come to abolish the law. Instead, he said in Matthew, remember this verse? He says in chapter 5, there in verse 17 and 18, he says, I came instead to fulfill the law. The law has a purpose. The law is my schoolmaster. We went over this 2 weeks ago. It teaches me I have sin. Once I know I'm a sinner, I got to do something about it. This is a serious problem. What do I do about it? And here, Paul says, here's what we find. That God can justify people who follow the law, the Jewish people, through the law instructing them and leading them. And even the ones who don't know the law, the Gentiles, us non-Jewish folks, he justifies us, it says, through faith. Through faith. We're made just because we have this faith, what we have put into the one who was sent to save us, Jesus. And then Paul, to bring home the point. Now, to Jews, they don't believe this. I mean, well, it takes a bit of, you actually have to explain it to them in their Jewish lingo, in their Jewish culture. You cannot say to a Jew, well, we're justified by faith in the Messiah. And they'll go, what? We're justified by the law. We have the law and the prophets. And you say, but the law and the prophets teach you that you have sin and that you need to look to the Messiah. And they'll get really, there are some very Orthodox Jews that believe it is through the law that they are saved, through their keeping of the law. And it's interesting because you can ask them, who's the father of the faith to a Jew? Do you guys know in their patriarchal society, who do they look at as the, I'm using with quotes, a man on this earth, they have a title that they call the father of the faith for the Jews. Who is he? Abraham. To them, that's their you know, solid go-to guy. And they'll say, well, we are sons of Abraham. We're descendants of Abraham. And you go, well, great. Now listen, the guy who's writing this down for us, this Paul, used to be called Saul of Tarsus, a Pharisee of Pharisees. Does he know the law? Does he know the prophets? One thing he also knows is their history. Something us Christians are sometimes a little bit vague on. So I'm going to give it to you today because this part will help you whenever you have to share with somebody, you know, Jew or Gentile. This might help you bring home the point of how we're just justified by this free gift of faith. This faith that can save us. It's the same thing. What made Abraham justified was this faith that he had. And I'm going to show you the faith, what he had, and explain to you a little bit of the history of the Jews just to help you fit this together. Because once you know this, once you lock this in your brain, you're going to be able to handle some questions that get thrown at you. Let me show you this. Abraham, in verse 1 of chapter 4 of Romans, it reads, what then shall we say that Abraham, our forefather, according to the flesh, has found? This is Paul talking, What did Abraham, our forefather, find? For if Abraham was justified by works, then he has something to boast about, but not before God. For what does the scripture say? Abraham believed God, and it was credited or accounted to him as what? As righteousness. Now those to the one who works, his wage is not credited as a favor, but as what is due. You know, if you do the job, you're owed the pay. Workman is worthy of his pay. He says, but the one who does not work, but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness. Just as it says, as David also speaks, of the blessing on the man whom God credits righteousness apart from works. He says, this is a quote, by the way, from Psalm 32. Blessed are those whose lawless deeds have been forgiven, and whose sins have been covered. And blessed is the man whom, it says, whose sin the Lord will not take into account. There went our amplifier, but just keep listening. So we're blessed How many feel blessed that God doesn't take your sin into account? I mean, it's a pretty good feeling, yeah? He's blessed. Blessed means how happy. How happy is the person who the Lord doesn't take his sin into account? Now he says, is this blessing then on the circumcised or on the uncircumcised also? Good question. Circumcised was the Jews. You know, they had to perform that act of cutting away of the foreskin of the male. That was circumcision. He says, is this blessing of faith only for those Jewish people or for the non-Jewish people alike? What's the blessing of faith? Just to the Jews? No. And to prove the point, this is really important for you to hear today. He asks this question. Is this, he says, for we say faith was credited to Abraham as righteousness. In verse 10, how then was it credited? Was it credited to Abraham when he was circumcised or when he was uncircumcised? When he was uncircumcised. This is really important if you don't know this in this story. It was he wasn't circumcised when God said, I account to you that as righteousness because you believe me. And so it says, now he received a sign of the sign of circumcision as a seal of the righteousness of faith, which he had while uncircumcised, so that he might be the father of all who believe. Being without circumcised, it says that righteousness might be credited to them, and the father of the circumcision to those who are not only of the circumcision, but those who also follow in the steps of faith of our father Abraham, which he had while uncircumcised. So he's the father to both the circumcised and the uncircumcised, because he was credited as faith. God said, Abraham, come here. I want to show you something. And he took him outside. You guys know the story in the scripture, right? He showed him the stars in the heavens. He said, can you number those? He says, so shall your descendants be. Now, I don't know if you guys know the story, but Abraham, he wasn't a young cat when this happened. Okay? He's about 75 years old. He and his wife, Sarah, had not had any children. She was 65, about 10 years younger. And he's going, look at the stars. You'll have more descendants than the stars. And Abraham, it says, believed God. And it pleased God. He said, well, you say so, Lord. I believe you. But it says he was walking by faith, not by sight, because it says he counted his own body as already dead. And he's like, look, I'm a little bit, it doesn't work anymore, Lord. It's, you know, we tried. No kids. Sorry. So, but yeah, he had faith. God, if you say so, I don't understand. I mean, how you're going to do it. But if you say, and then he's got to wait for this promise that God made. Does anyone know this story? Does he have a baby the next year? Next 10 years? No. 25 years. God's like, you know, it would not be enough of a miracle if you had one at 85. I'm going to wait till you're 100 to have a kid, you know. And Sarah, she'll be 90. Let's not stack this against them. Let's not make this a miracle. I mean, the Lord like literally made it like, let's just wait. You know, Abraham, I'm so pleased that you believe me. But, you know, sometimes God speaks stuff to us. This is important to note. God can speak something to your heart and say, I'm going to do this for you. And you're like, well, it ain't happening. And, you know, when the Lord says, it's going to happen, just wait. Wait a couple of minutes. A couple of minutes to the Lord is not a couple of minutes to me. I'm just saying. The Bible says, with the Lord, one day is how many years on earth? Like 1,000. Now, I broke this down because sometimes he says, wait a minute or wait a second. I don't know how to tell you this, but just if he says, wait a second, you know, I'll be with you in just a second. I'm going to answer you and just say, do you know how much time that is if you do the math? One day of God equals 1,000 years of man. I broke it down. It's 4 days and about 2/3. 1 second of his time is 4 days and 2/3 a day, our time. If he says, wait a minute, we're in trouble. If he says it's going to be an hour, that's like 40 years our time. So in God's economy, When he said, Abraham, I'm going to make you a father of many nations, and Abraham went, I believe you, Lord. It was going to be about a half an hour of God's time. But 25 years for Abraham down here. Just pointing it out. And that 25 years of waiting, it says he still believed God. By faith. See, but faith is an amazing thing in our lives. When we have faith that God can do something. Now, by the way, along the way, he kind of had a little lapse in his faith, and his wife, she kind of had a little help in the story. You remember, she said, it ain't really happening. I'm not getting any younger. Why don't you go into my maidservant and have a child with her, and I'll catch the baby and raise it as our son, and, you know, we'll help. And that son, his name, does anyone remember his name? Ishmael. He would become the one that was the child, what we read about in the scripture, that was the child according to the efforts of the flesh. The one that would become a thorn in the side of the child that would be the son by promise. And by the way, to this date, all of the descendants of Ishmael over there in the Middle East, you might wonder where they are, like over there where the ISIS group is and the Syria and those guys. Those are descendants of Ishmael. And who do they want to fight with? The descendants, yeah, of Isaac. Isaac, by the way, is the other son of promise. So Abraham has Isaac. Isaac has Jacob. Jacob wrestles the angel, gets his name changed to Israel. We say Israel in English. And he gets his name changed. He has 12 sons, a couple different wives, gets 12 kids. They become the 12 tribes of Israel. One of those tribes, the name of it is Levi. And through that tribe comes a guy named Moses and his cousin Aaron. And they come out of the tribe of Levi. And just to put this into perspective, so that you know this, Abraham believed God, we would say, around 2010 BC. Moses will get the law about 14, for those that like timelines, I'm just helping you out on the timeline, about 1450 BC. Is when Moses will go up on the mountain, get the two tablets, and come down. So the law, what the Jews really like to hold to, which hasn't been broken down from the 10 into 613 more little sub-statutes, I mean just the 10 biggies, they're about 700 years of time between the time Abraham believed God and Moses gets the law. I'm only telling you this because this is important. If the law was so important that we'd be justified by the law, why did God wait so long to bring the law into the picture? You know, why not put the law up first before Abraham? Couldn't he have just given the tablets to Abraham? I mean, what's the problem with that? See, because he was trying to show the one that the Jews point to as the father of the faith was justified by faith before there ever was a law. And by the way, the circumcision wasn't part of the law. The circumcision came before the law. As a mark of, how did it read? Because he believed, then he received the sign of circumcision as a seal of righteousness of the faith that he already had. It was just this is my way of saying I really believe God. I'm going to follow his way. He made a promise. I'll have to walk it, and then he'll bring it to pass. And God brought the promise to pass and gave him a son, finally, named Isaac, which in Hebrew I love, because me and Isaac, we have the same nickname, Is. No, I'm kidding. In Hebrew, Isaac means he, as in God, and do you know what it means? He laughs. Ha, ha, ha. God goes, you think you're funny? I get the last laugh. Because, see, Sarah didn't believe it. She was in her tent laughing. And God told Abraham, your wife's in the tent laughing. She doesn't believe it's going to happen. By this time next year when I come back, she'll be with child. And Abraham's like, I'm 99. Sarah's like 89. Lord, I don't know how to tell you this. Why don't you let Ishmael live before you? And he goes, no. I made you a promise, and you believed the promise, and I'll bring it to pass. And she's in the tent laughing about it. So go tell her I heard her. And he goes in and he says, you are laughing. Oh, I wasn't laughing, honey. Yes, you were. And a year later, when she gives birth to this child, and the Lord says, his name will be, who gets the last laugh? He laughs. Can you imagine? From then on, this kid, talk about raising the kid. Hey, he laughs. Come here. God's laughing, I know. Yeah, I mean, she's the one that gave birth at 90. She'd be going, ah, he got the last laugh on me. Every time she called her son, hey, God's laughing. Come here. She knew God got the last laugh on this one. I love it. But see, Abraham was able to be just with God without following any law. If your friends ever say, do we have to follow the law now that we're Christians? Did Abraham have to follow the law? The law wasn't around. Wasn't going to be around for about 700 more years. I'm sorry, he didn't follow the law. What he followed was what God spoke, he believed. How about you? When God speaks something to your heart, do you believe him? See, because all he says is, if you believe what I say, I credit it to you that you're right with me. See, what makes me right with God is that I have faith in what he says. If he says, I sent my son to die for you, that he could pay for every blot of sin in your life and blot it out for you. And I go, I could use that. I believe you. Then God says, you are now right with me because you have accepted the right payment for your sin. You could try to pay for your own sin, by the way. Did you know that? According to the law. What's the payment for your own sin? Do you guys know? It's a blood sacrifice. That's right. Whose blood do you have to sacrifice? Your own. So you only have to bleed all your blood out of your body into a bowl, offer it as an offering to God. Oh, and there's one catch. Do you guys know the catch, right? What's the catch? You have to stay alive. See, because you offer up your blood, and what happens to our body? We die. The Bible says the life is in the blood. The only thing that can cover death, by the way, the wages of sin is death. So you want to cover death and cover it up? Got to use what? Life. And that means blood has to be shed. That's why we sing all these songs in Christian circles about the blood of Jesus. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. I've been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Why? Because that's what it paid. That's the cost. Somebody's blood had to be shed. And the Bible says it had to be a perfect lamb, a perfect offering. That's why when John the Baptist saw him, he said, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. His blood paid for my sin. Do I get to brag how great I am? Paul's saying, where then is boasting? My boasting can only be in one thing. I have a really good lamb that paid for my sin, and his name is Jesus. The great sacrifice God made in sending his only begotten son to this world so he could pay for me. And I get to receive that as a gift. Just like when you're talking to your friends and they're like, well, what do I have to do to be saved? Just tell them, it's a gift. What do you have to do to get any gift? If I said, okay, guys, I'm going to give away my iPhone today. Who wants it? You know, I'm just going to, hands are going up all over. This is great. It's an old one. The button's missing. It's not that. But with any gift, when it's offered, I better just point it toward my wife because someone won't give it back. But when it's offered, all we have to do is just receive it. I mean, your friends are like, how do I get this forgiveness for my sin? What you have. And you know what's interesting? When you know your sins are forgiven, does it change your outlook? Does it change how you carry yourself, you know? The Bible says that sin is like a weight. It just weighs us down. And some of you know, you have friends or family members weighed down with sin, and it's bending them low. They are hurting. Maybe it doesn't look on the shoulders on the outside, but on the inside I'm talking about, the weight. And the strain on them, and they're struggling, and they're like, and you come walking in going, I feel great. Do they see that in you? When you come walking in just feeling, man, it's a good day. My sins are washed away. I feel good. I can move. Until I found out my sins were washed away, I couldn't move on. I couldn't go forward in my faith. I couldn't go forward in this journey of this life. Those things are like emotional fetters, like bonds, you know, chains and shackles. When we have sin, it just like ties us up. And we're not free to just walk around and enjoy life. So God goes, I want to take care of that for you. And all you have to do to receive this forgiveness is ask. Just say, God, let that count for me too. Forgive my sins like you did those other guys. And when you do that, the Lord will forgive you. And it won't be on the basis of any works that you do. It's just it's a free gift that you received. So let's pray for anyone who hasn't received that. There might be some that watch this later on YouTube. I feel so blessed. I went on to close my computer before I came this morning, and Dylan and the boys helped me. We set up Russian Facebook. Because, you know, when you share a video from our YouTube channel, we can share to Google+ and tweet it, and we can do all these different, there's like a bunch of icons. One day I was like, what's this icon? And I clicked it, and the guys are like, what are you doing, Pastor? I said, you guys said I have to grow in social media. I don't know what it is. I just pushed the button. He says, would you like to use your Facebook profile? I said, okay. Turns out it was Russian Facebook. I have Russian Facebook now. And I looked this morning, I have 1,600 friends on Russian Facebook. And you know what my Russian Facebook wall has? That's all I have is posts. I have two pictures, one of me and one of me with my family. And all the rest is posts of my sermons from YouTube. And at first we got one view of every time a video was put up there. And they do it nicer than American Facebook. They have a nice big picture of the front thing with what Dylan makes with the title and everything. And then all the writing is all like wrapped around real nice. And it's just real appealing, you know, like really nice. I'm a visual person. It's like, wow, that looks better than American Facebook. And it always had one person watched it. I'm like, somebody in Russia is watching my sermon. Maybe they have to. Like, what's this guy, a communist or what? I mean, I don't know. But they're watching my video. And then it started changing. Now the message on everlasting life had like 40 watches. It said his promise, eternal life. And 40 different people in Russia have watched it. And it's got like 10 or 12 likes. And I'm like, okay, cool, Lord. Because I hope someday, like we only have one token Russian, Sasha. He comes and goes, you know. And I said, someday, what if we get to heaven and someone goes, hey, I heard about Jesus because of, I watched you on YouTube. And I think, Lord, you know, you're really cool because I don't know Russian, you know, but I know you. And I know the gift that you gave me, you want to give to others. And some of you have friends and families that you want them to know about this gift. And you're like, but I'm not a good speaker. I can't explain it like that. Just tell them, watch it on YouTube. It'll be up in a couple days. Dylan will get it on the thing. And you'll see, you know, what are we justified by? By faith. It's just a gift. Abraham was justified by his faith. Just a gift from God. He just believed God. God said it. He said, okay, I'll work with that. I believe you, Lord. You know, sometimes we make it too complicated, don't we? The gospel, some people put too many extra little things onto it, and it's not meant that way. And I think we need to boil it down to what it's simplicity. What is it really? So people can really, because I don't think Jesus, when he preached, made it difficult. I don't think he put a lot of extra little conditions. If you believe and you do missions and you go to get, you know, so many attendance stickers and you put so much money in the box and you go do that, and right? And you contribute to the building fund and you... No. He said, if you believe. This is the work which you must do. They asked him, what work should we do to do the work of God? He said, believe on him whom God has sent. Remember that in John's gospel? That's the only work you get to do. Do you get to brag about that? Yeah, I believe. I'm bragging about it. May you believe and may your faith light the way for others to come to believe. And just remember, we're all just sinners in the club. So if I sin and I'm not perfect, you already knew that going in, right? I shouldn't startle people. The pastor sinned. He should go, no, man, he's doing way better than he used to. I mean, he's sinning a lot less. He's a work in progress, you know. Tell him that. Because aren't we all works in progress? How are we going to let people really know about a God who helps us continue? I know I'm in a better way now than I used to be. But I don't feel like I'm where I want to be. Does anyone else share that feeling in your faith? That there's more that you want to grow in. There's more that you want to get better at. But you're not there yet. Just remember what Paul wrote there. As he said, he who began a good work, God who began a good work, is faithful to what? To complete it. Let's let him complete in each of us that work he's doing. And just understand, it's by faith. Just a gift. May your faith grow this day. May your friends who listen to this later that don't have faith, may it just help them come to faith. The Bible says faith just comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of God. We just need to hear what God did. And it resonates with our soul. When the gospel is presented truly in that pure form for what it is, what Christ did for us, our spirit inside goes, yeah, that's right. We know. It's something we're wired for. We're like, that's a true fit. That's what it's about. So may your faith be like Abraham's. When God speaks something to you, may you just be able to believe God and what he says he's going to do. And if it should take time, since we're on Abraham, if it shouldn't happen right away, does that mean you should quit believing? No, just be like Abraham. Just go, well, he promised, I'm just going to wait. You know, his promises, some of them take a little bit of setup time for all the pieces to line up for that promise to come to pass. I know Rebecca's waiting for some promises, and maybe Barnabas, a couple, you know. Anyone else here waiting on God for some promises, what you know he wants to do, besides me? Let's have faith and patience like Abraham. And let's don't be like Sarah and be laughing in the tent. Because he'll get the last laugh, I guarantee you. He will, man. He'll set you up, and then he'll be chuckling, going, they didn't think I was going to pull this one off. You know, God, who here believes God has a sense of humor? If you don't, look around. I mean, you look at the diversity of all of us. You know God has a sense of humor. With you, we know. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. Thank you for that breeze which has started to blow. I just ask that you would continue to let it blow, Lord, as it would blow through here, Lord, to refresh our bodies, but accompany it with a blowing of your Holy Ghost to refresh our spirits. Lord, and those that have been waiting on promises from you, Lord, we just ask that you would let their heart be refreshed and girded up and strengthened today. As we pray to you, Lord, make us be able to stand in that faith that you will do what you have promised. Lord, you will complete that work which you have begun in us. Please take us from here, continuing our faith to grow and continuing us to be able to see your hand in fulfilling those things what you have spoke to our hearts, Lord. If some have not received those things from you, I pray today you would just speak to them. Just as you spoke to Abraham, Lord, speak to each of us what we need to get us ready for what lies ahead this week. We ask it in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said, amen. Amen. Would you stand with me? Let's sing a closing song and send you in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo and God bless.